This is the stunning all-new Mac Mini design with the first design update since 2010. Look how tiny it is, 5x5. The previous Mac Mini has been a staple of IT departments around the world, used for Zoom stations, conference room setups, digital signage, desktop computers. I've used it for all those things, as well as a rackable, portable, storable desktop. It was fantastic. I love the previous design, and I love this much more compact design even more. Yes, we've had the Mac Studio and other Mac desktops and laptops, but the Mac Mini has always been the most versatile of the bunch. The day has finally arrived that it is now smaller and more compact than its predecessor, although it is quite a bit taller. Think of it almost like a Mac Studio miniaturized, minus the SD card slot on the front, which honestly, as a creator, I will miss. That being said, at least we get some front ports. Whoops, over on this side. And the headphone jack as well. One wacky thing to note is that the power button is on the bottom of the unit, and there's been a lot of debate over the last couple of days since this was announced as to whether or not that is, nice and clicky, as to whether or not that's actually a problem. If it's sitting on your desk, you have to actually lift the unit up, get your finger under there, and find the, honestly, nicely indented hole there, but you still have to find it and push the button in order to turn it on. That being said, how often do we really fully turn off our Macs these days? If you're going to be rebooting, a reboot doesn't require pushing the button, and if you lose power, the Mac has a capability to automatically bring itself back online from power loss. That being said, it's still almost like the guy who designed the Magic Mouse also had a hand in this button over here and said, no, we're not going to put it on the front or on the sides, we're going to put it underneath. It is annoying and a bit wacky, but I suppose, worst case scenario, you could just have your Mac Mini sit like this and then the power button is on the top. Pretty sure anybody at Apple who worked on this is now cringing watching people do this. But that's what you get. On the back here, we have three Thunderbolt 5 ports for the first time ever, which are crazy fast, an HDMI port and a 1 or 10 gigabit Ethernet port, depending on what you select. And on the front, you've got two USB-C ports, an indicator light, and a headphone jack. These Thunderbolt 5 ports on the back are so new, I don't even have anything that is compatible with that. Of course, Thunderbolt 4 can plug into here and do Thunderbolt 4 speeds, but Thunderbolt 5 will be coming to more devices as time progresses. Good news from what I've seen internally from the teardowns, this is relatively easy to pull off. A little bit of spudger action on the sides, and directly underneath in the center here is a removable CMOS battery. So if you are using these for long enough, which I imagine you are, that battery starts to die, it looks really easy to be able to replace that. Another thing that's a first, I believe, for this form factor is a removable SSD. That being said, it's a custom Apple SSD, and you're going to have to either severely hack it in order to get it to fit, or use a module from Apple, be it from another computer or from the Apple supply directly. With the Thunderbolt ports in the back, you are able to connect up to three displays simultaneously on the Pro chip, specifically, up to 4K at 144 Hertz. You are able to go up to a higher resolution, all the way up to 8K, but you're going to lose how many monitors you can use. That being said, if you have a ginormous 8K screen in front of you, you will be able to power it with this device. All right, let's talk performance. This thing is insanely fast. The M4 series chips are absolutely incredible. And if you're on anything pre-M2, you're gonna wanna pay attention. M1 for sure, or the Intel-based Macs, you should just walk out, stop this video, go to your store and buy this right now because it is that much of a drastic increase. Now, personally, I'm running my MacBook Pro 14 using an M3 Max chip. I do not feel the need to upgrade. Even with the new M4 Max chips, I am a little bit tempted, but I think I'm going to wait another year because I am still getting serious power out of my Mac, and it doesn't even stutter when I'm editing multiple 4K streams in Final Cut Pro. I'll leave the benchmarks for those other videos, as you can get crazy nuanced in those details, and there are plenty of videos out there that already do that. Compared to the M1 version of the Mac Mini, you get a footprint that's less than half the size, faster Wi-Fi with Wi-Fi 6E internally. Thunderbolt 5 ports on the back, which I talked about before, are incredibly fast. And on the front are USB-C that's capable, it's USB-C 3, I think, which is pretty good, although nothing compared to like 120 gigabits per second that the Thunderbolt 5 can do. One complaint I do have about this immediately is, why is it Wi-Fi 7? All the new Macs are Wi-Fi 7. I get it's not a pro model device, but seriously, you're buying something in 2024. Lots of devices out there supporting Wi-Fi 7, including the new iPhones. Why doesn't this have Wi-Fi 7 on it? To give you an idea, the specs that I recommend for this are the M4 Pro with a 12-core CPU, 16-core GPU, and 16-core neural engine. Additionally, I recommend 24 gig or 48 gig of RAM and a 512 or 1 terabyte hard drive. Obviously, if you need more space, go higher, but with these massive Thunderbolt drives in the back, you can also connect external storage. In this configuration with the 24 gig and, as mentioned, previous specifications, it comes out to $1,600. But it's incredibly powerful and, honestly, I think the best value for the money today. If you need more power, you can, of course, upgrade to a 14-core M4 Pro with a 20-core GPU and up to 64 gig of RAM fully loaded. That configuration, though, does get pricey really fast. A fully loaded Mac Mini does run $4,700, but if you drop the hard drive down to 1 terabyte instead of 8 terabytes, you save $2,200 right off the bat. Then you're looking at fully loaded minus the storage for $2,500, which for a production machine is really not that bad if you need that kind of power. That being said, I think most people are going to be able to get away with just the base model of this, not even the Pro, which starts at a very affordable $600, and if you have an education discount, it's even cheaper. Personally, if you're looking to future-proof it a little bit, I would add on the extra RAM to 24 gig for an extra $200, and then double the storage to 512 for another $200, bringing it to a cool grand. All in all, whether you get the base device or the Pro device, I think this is an excellent offering. Apple, you've hit it out of the park. Well done. Next time, fix the button and Wi-Fi 7. Thank you. For more videos like this, please like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.